I would ask you, though, and I've been thinking about this since I saw the film, how do you make a film about an artist? How do you illustrate the motivations that create art? And how is there a risk that you just produce a portrait of a rather boring...
Well, it's interesting that because when I was preparing the film, when I was, you know, through a long period, I looked at, I don't usually do this, but I did look at a lot of film. This is going to be very distracting, you see. Can you have a seat? Or leave. I did look at at pretty well all the films there are, the feature films, about artists, and there are quite a lot. And they vary, you'll be familiar with some of them, they vary from some really good films, like Robert Altman made a very nice film
called
Van Gogh, Vincent and Theo, and there's a very old and quite nice film by Korda with Charles Laughton as Rembrandt, made in the 1930s. There's a terribly boring film by a great British filmmaker who I knew and liked before he died, but it's a very tedious film of Caravaggio by Derek Jarman, but it's beautiful. It beautifully looks like a Caravaggio, but it's deeply, deeply boring because nothing happens in it at all, is it? The problem is that it's like films about great composers and things. It's very hard to, because what we're concerned with as filmmakers, are we not, is to film, you know, to capture moments in which things are happening, and to capture the moment of creativity is a very elusive thing. And on the whole, I think what we've tried to do in Mr. Turner, and I hope in some way succeeded, is to look at, first of all, look at the man, the personality, the life, and then look at the relationship to the environment. But there are there's hardly a moment in the film where you actually see what is the moment of creativity. I mean, you could argue in a theoretical way that when he sees the great old ship, the Temeraire, being towed to be broken up, which really happened, you could say, well, that's a moment of inspiration, but it's not really the creative moment. And the thing is, I mean, the paradox is that we all understand the creative moment because that's what we do. And in a way, for me, making a film like this film, Mr. Turner, is really by way of turning the camera around and looking at ourselves and what we do. So it's quite hard, in fact, I refused, I made a decision, an instinctive decision, not to struggle with trying to stage that creative moment, but merely to deal with as many aspects of the life as possible and put them together and hope that it would in some way imply the creative journey.
Yes, you don't want to focus too much on his relationship with landscapes and light.
The point is, we said at the beginning when we started to prepare the film, decide what we were going to do, we said, well, you can't just have him walking about the landscape all the time, because that's what he did. I mean, he travelled everywhere. I mean, there are some very tragic things about this film because it was a low budget. I mean, one of the things that we didn't do, that we expected before we realised it was impossible, that we would inevitably do, is that you would see Turner in Venice, because he went to Venice a lot, he painted Venice, he was inspired by Venice, and indeed he went all over Europe, everywhere. We couldn't really afford to do any of that, really. He just walked and tramped and travelled and went everywhere, and you know. So there's a bit of that in the film, but only enough to give you a sense of it. But if the film consisted of massive amounts of that, again, it would be profoundly boring, really, and not say anything, and not.
I think you do that very effectively in the opening scene, don't you? I mean, that sort of sets the.
Well, you do. Yes, we do in the opening scene, and then later. You see him here and there in the landscape, but you can't make too much. And it's looking at the sea. But once you've done that, you can't go on and on doing that because it's just dull, basically.
How much of yourself did you relate to in Turner? I mean, did you feel that you were talking about your own experience as well?
Yeah, not in a very conscious way. I mean, it's not other than the given fact that I've already just referred to, that we're making a film about.
Creativity.
Yeah. You know, I mean, of course, you know, we are all of us here in one way or another. You would all agree that we are all outsiders in a sense, so we wouldn't be filmmakers. You know, we're people looking at the world objectively through our own special lens, you know. One can identify with and understand the man.
Yeah.
But then that's the job. Anyway, is to empathise and understand with one's characters, whoever they are or whatever they do, be they good or bad, really. But only in an obvious way.
We're talking about visual storytelling here. This is clearly and obviously one of your most visually self-conscious films, if you like. You know, because self-conscious in that it's about a very renowned artist.
I mean, I have difficulty with the idea that. This is one of my most visual films, because I don't know which films of mine aren't visual, basically. I mean, the criteria which govern how I look at the world and how I share with Dick Pope, my cinematographer, and indeed with the other designer and so forth, it's the same whether we're looking at Turner in his time and space and period, or whether we're looking at the contemporary characters in the suburban house. It's we're still looking at the world with the same distilling eye and the same disciplines, and the visual is what it's about, basically.
So. I think if you look at the Oscars, the cinematography prize always goes to a sweeping epic, you know. I think we always perceive.
Well, that's right, but I mean,
films of scale as more visual.
You know, here's the thing: if you're talking about painting, as far as I'm concerned, you know, there are great epic painters, but one of the greatest painters of all is Vermeer, and Vermeer actually, you know, really. Looks at exactly what I like to look at, which is somebody in a room, you know, just, and it all going on, you know. We always lament the fact that the prizes always go to those films which are obviously visual, but, you know, we who make films that are not, as you say, self-consciously, obviously visual, we accept that this is our fate in life, to be ignored because, well, it's just people in a room.
Not very visual at all.
No.
The art form, of course, of painting is a very singular thing. I mean, he has people who support him in his work here in the film, very obviously, but filmmaking is completely different, isn't it? And you have surrounded yourself with a team of people that speak your creative language.
Yeah, I mean, now I'm not going to say anything anything I'm about to say is too obvious to insult members of the talent campus with. But of course, it is filmmaking is collaborative, and there's no question that if you can't and aren't naturally inclined. To start with, from a film director's point of view, if you're not naturally inclined and don't have the ability to share and to give and take and to draw from other people's contributions and to have and to pull them together into what becomes ostensibly a singular vision, then you're in the wrong game. I mean, of course, you can be a filmmaker and operate absolutely all by yourself. You know, you don't have to make feature films or films that involve entire crews. You can go out, you can get a camera and shoot and make footage and make film and, you know, be an artist who does that. Mm. But if you're going to do something which by its nature draws on the serious skills of a whole range of people, then, you know, that's the name of the game. And it has to be a real contribution. And you have to be able to create a forum in which everybody really is, as you say, on the same page. I mean, you've got to be lucky, in a sense. You've got to find the right people. Not every cinematographer and every director are going to be a perfect marriage, you know, and that's true of designers and everybody else. I mean, there are people who really pull in the opposite direction or happen not to have the same sense of humour or be on the same page about the nature of what it's about, you know, or to have the same values. And it is a matter of luck to some extent who you actually meet. But gradually, if you are able to, it is about building up a team, really.
It's interesting because when you watch a Mike Leigh film, you hear, I certainly hear your voice through it. I feel that I hear your voice, which is not terribly common, to be honest. When you're watching a film, you don't necessarily feel that the filmmaker is speaking to you.
Well, I suppose, I mean, I take that as the compliment, I'm sure it is, and thank you for it. I hope it's true. Part of the thing, so far as my own films is concerned, is that because of the way I work, which is to say, first of all, I don't get hired to a project. I mean, I decide what the projects are, and then, you know, I don't write a script, and we don't discuss casting, and we don't discuss any. I mean, the films are made with complete freedom to do just whatever I want to do within the constraints of the budget, and because that's all about assembling a whole lot of people on both sides of the camera, actors and crew. And the job then is to go on a journey of creative discovery as to what the film is, so that the idea is expand and contract as we go. You know, you sort of develop something and it grows and something new happens and you take from that and something happens in an improvisation or a location. I mean, every scene in every one of my films you've ever seen, the scene itself has been created by improvising and then structuring and rehearsing in the location. Mm. So the location informs. And so for all those reasons, it means that I have the freedom, because I'm never interfered with by backers or anything, I have the freedom to take it and to build it, to create it in the way that painters make paintings and musicians make music and poets write poetry and novelists write novels, you know, that you are, and everybody comes with me on the journey. So in that sense, it means that I'm not inhibited or constrained or limited by preconceived notions. I mean, one of the problems with the general convention of script into film, and I don't have you will not hear me advocating not having scripts, because a good script is a good script, and that's the classic way of making films. But the downside of that whole convention, with everybody planning everything in advance and working out every detail before anybody's gone anywhere near the location with a camera or the studio, the problem with that is that, you know, the film has been made in everybody's head before the real creative job of investigating the organic thing itself has even begun. And that's a big danger, obviously. It's a danger that is... Bless you. That's a danger that's even that's easily overcome by good work. But still, it's a danger. Whereas I don't have that problem, because even right up to before we start shooting, I've done a lot of development work. We've done a massive amount of preparation with defining characters. As Marion Bailey said last night, you know, by the time it starts shooting, she knows who she is. And not only that, but the relationships with the interrelationships with the characters have been created, and all sorts of stuff is already on the go. Not until we start shooting do we really start to investigate, to create something that didn't previously exist. And even with a film like this, which is based on a historical background, that is still the case. Mm. You
know? And topsy-turvy.
And of course.
Tell us, I mean, it's a unique situation that you've developed over a long career, that you're allowed to do this. What are the sort of logistical cost implications if you're doing 5 months, 6 months?
Well, it's about...
Before shooting.
Well, it's about spending the money on what's necessary and not wasting it on what isn't.
Yeah.
And if the deal is that... I mean, when I used to make films for the BBC, there was a long period after my first feature film where you couldn't make independent feature films in the UK, but you could in the BBC. And they used to say, the BBC was great actually, it was a very creative and positive time. They'd say, okay, those are the dates, those are the filming dates, there's the budget, go and make a film. And what I would do is go in and look at the budget and say, okay, well, this amount is down there for foreign travel. Well, this amount is down there for certain things that you knew we didn't need, you know. So let's take from there, and let's put it there, and that can fund the rehearsals. So what we do now, 100 years later, making these featured films, don't laugh, it's 100 years, now, is we simply say, well, X is the budget. How can we divide that up? I mean, you know, it works as crudely as this. My producer will say, well, you could have a year's rehearsal with two actors, or 6 months rehearsal with 20 actors, or 2 weeks rehearsal with 150 actors, you know. I mean, that's a crude formula. And that is a decision to spend X amount of money on the preparation as opposed to Y amount of money on the shoot and the film, you know. Then there are discussions about how long we can shoot for, how many weeks shooting, because that's the really... I mean, the rehearsals are a relatively cheap commodity.
Yeah.
And the actors, certainly under the union agreements in that we have in the UK, the actors are on half the wages for the rehearsal that they get for shooting. It's about doing what every film of every kind needs to do, which is to decide on your priorities and to allocate the money accordingly.
How many weeks did Mr. Turner shoot for?
16.
So that's a long shoot.
It is. Yeah. It is. And as always, I mean, it was down for less. And what happens is you gradually... I mean, you've got to have a very good producer. You really do, and that's key to the whole thing. My producer, Georgina Lowe, is fantastic at really finding ways of making things happen, but keeping a real grip on what is being spent. So that, for example, I wanted to have that very brief scene with a train, where he sees a train. Now, if you know the painting that he made, which is called Rain, Steam and Speed, it's very important. It's still interesting even if you don't know that painting. It's in the National Gallery in London, of a train. And of course, Turner was obviously very taken with new technology at the time. There was the debate about whether we could do the train and how we could do the train and where we could do the train and what it would cost, above all, carried on into the shoot, and we weren't sure whether we were going to be able to do it or not. But gradually, by working out tricks and strategies, it was decided that there is this old train in a museum in Manchester. And it runs up and down a track outside for about 30 metres, and kids could go on it and on school parties and things. And what we did is we managed to persuade them to let us hire this whole thing for a relatively low amount, put it on a low loader, drive it to Wales, and put it on this closed railway track. Film it.
Wow, that's a big thing.
I know. Yeah. But the thing was, it's quite interesting, the thing was, well, I said, but, you know, you've got and the two guys came with from Manchester who know how to drive it, so then we put them in costume. And I said, well, it's all very well, but there's nobody in the carriages. So they said, and then the word was, we cannot afford to put people in the carriages. So therefore, the designer photographed people in costume, and there were photographs. There were actual photographs in the, but you don't really see it. It goes so quickly. But this train was going through the countryside with all these photographs of Victorian people sitting in the back. But the point was, relatively late in the day, when we shot quite a lot of the film, it was still not sure whether we'd be able to do that. And, you know, I think it's a bonus when you see it. You know?
Yeah, no, of course. I mean, there was a question last night about your characters and the richness and the detail of the characters, which Marion talked about as well. You know, you'd think other filmmakers would follow your lead, you know, and try and ape your system. You know, I'm not saying that you're replicable, but you know.
I don't know anything about that. I mean, because I think, excuse me, what I do, I think what I do is pretty idiosyncratic and eccentric. And I don't, I think it's, people should do whatever they want to do. I don't know. I mean, the way I go about things is quite specific to the job, really.
But I do think, and you probably don't look at body of work necessarily, but I do look at your body of work, and I don't see any missteps like you see in other filmmakers' careers. You know, there's a through line and an authenticity to it.
I would say,
you
know, get glasses.
Let's talk about television for a second. You know that there's talk at the moment of a television renaissance, and a lot of film directors and actors are working happily in television. You, of course, were a pioneer of great television. Do you think there's a renaissance now?
It depends what you're talking about. I mean, there's certainly, not least from Denmark and actually from the States, which never used to be the case, it's interesting. High-end television. You know, the real point is, I don't have a lot to say about this, because when I used to, for 12 or 14 years, I used to make television films, it was just making films that were shown on television.
Yeah.
But as far as I was concerned, as far as we were all concerned, the job was we were making films. And they only weren't movies because you couldn't make movies, but they were films.
Yeah.
And hopefully they stood up as proper dramatic films. And so television is an outlet for stuff. And there's no reason why it shouldn't produce good things.
Good work.
The difference now in television from the time when I used to make television films is at that time there were only two or three channels. eventually four channels. That's in the UK, but the same was true everywhere.
Really. Yeah.
Now, because of the whole, everything has changed, there are endless numbers of channels that compete with each other, and therefore the values are affected. You know, I have nothing really more to say.
You're a British filmmaker, obviously. You've made all of your films in Britain, I think. Are you interested in working in other countries, in Europe, in America?
I'm not interested. I'm very cautious about making films in America. I think there's the assumption that if you're a filmmaker, especially an English language filmmaker, you automatically go to America. Is a ridiculous assumption, and I won't have anything to do. I certainly wouldn't go to Hollywood. The real point is that, as I said last night, I mean, I think, you know, we are part of world cinema, serious cinema, and I think it's important, and it's important for all of us here, that, you know, you really make films that come out of the world you understand, and the things you care about, and the things you have to talk about. And that is as true for us in Western Europe as it is for those of you here in Eastern Europe or wherever. So far as I'm concerned, the commitment on one level is to make films that are hopefully in some way universal and meaningful. I'll come back to that in a minute. On another level, I'm committed to making films that come out of a culture and a region that I understand and care about. But on another level, which is quite a different, separate matter, but equally important, is I am committed to the British film industry. Because there is an industry and there's an infrastructure, and if we don't make films, and we don't, you know, work at developing our indigenous cinema, then it's not healthy, basically. It's particularly an issue in London, because, you know, because we speak English, we are the natural place for Hollywood films to come and use our industry, and that's what
happens.
Which they do, and you know, that's great from the point of view of keeping people in jobs and keeping the technology being used and so forth. But it's bad news for indigenous films. Yeah. So I'm committed to that as well, and that's important. But you know, as an internationalist, you know, I'm conflicted by people say, well, as you just have, well, why don't you make films here, there, and everywhere? But the fact is, I mean, most of my films, for practical and economic reasons, have been made not only in the UK but in London, because it's more expensive to go out of London than to stay in London. But what I try and do is to make films that are, although the locale is very specific, that in some way go beyond that and are hopefully universal in their subject matter and their meaning. And I think the evidence would be that since they do seem to travel quite a lot, that sort of works, basically.
I suppose it's also part of your reputation that you've developed over many years, that you've been to festivals and you've won prizes, and you become your own brand to some extent, you know, the Mike Leigh brand, you know, which comes with many years in the business.
I can only agree with that statement.
So tell us about the Cannes Film Festival. You know, it's seen by many.
What do you want to know?
It's seen by many as the sort of the acme of world cinema, as you say. And you've played there many times. You played there this year. Timothy Spall won the acting prize.
You know, people say, ask to what festivals do you like? You know, I mean, you know, we're at the Sarajevo Film Festival, which is one sort of an experience. What sort of an experience is it? We're here, we're having this seminar, we are, you know, it's an audience festival, it's about celebration of film. There's a bit of, the Sarajevo Festival has developed a bit of red carpet stuff, but it's not really the essence of what this festival is about. It's an audience festival, you know? Yeah. It's a people's festival. Cannes is a whole different ballgame. It's an international market. It's, you know, it has a different function. I think it's an important function in terms of the overall life of cinema in the world. What's great, what I love about Cannes more than anything, is the fact that that Hollywood cannot get in there other than on its own merits. They can't buy their way in. You know, you arrive in Cannes, the whole of the Croisette is covered in great big billboards advertising American blockbusters.
Transformers and...
You name it, but they can't bully their way into the... the competition and the festival, because the festival is about a celebration of world cinema. And as I said last night, there's world cinema and there's Hollywood, and we mustn't ever forget that, you know.
But of course, there's also the world's critics. I mean, it is the premier platform
it's
for...
great. And I mean, you know, from the point of view of filmmakers like me, you know, the 8:30 in the morning press screening of, say, Mr. Turner that we had a few months ago... with that number of world journalists, I mean, it's just a bonus. It's great, you know.
And that's the first time anybody's seen it, presumably, at this point,
absolutely.
Outside the...
Yeah, but I mean, you know, I've been to Cannes, I think, 5 times in competition, and I was on the jury 1 year in 1997. And
you won the Palme d'Or in 96?
Yes. I have to say, I feel lucky and privileged to have only ever been there with a purpose. That's to say, either because I had a filming competition or I was on the jury. Mm. A lot of people go with an open brief and just hoping that they'll be able to get into films, hoping that they can meet people, hoping that something will happen. And I don't think I would care for that too much, really. I think it's really tough and, you know...
There are many scenes of Turner showing his paintings, of him listening to the Queen eviscerate his paintings. How are you with critics? How are you with when you first expose something you've been working on for years to this foreign sort of alien crowd?
Well, just a question, what do I feel about critics? I mean, serious critics, well, critics who really are... truthfully expressing what their reaction is, whatever that may be, fine. Mm. It's the cynical critics, which we are blessed. The place most afflicted with cynical criticism is actually London. Actually,
how do you think?
Yeah, definitely. Yeah. My experience with critics and journalists in New York or Paris or Berlin or a whole bunch of other places. It is much more positive in the sense that you don't get cynicism. But I mean, it's varied from film to film. I mean, with Happy Go Lucky, for example, some critics are you're familiar with Happy Go Lucky? A lot of you. I mean, some critics, most critics got it and liked it, appreciated it. But some people said, oh God, I wanted to murder her by the end. She was terrible, that terrible woman. You wanted to kill her by the end. She was so irritating with all that jollity. Well, of course, you think, well, where were they? What were they doing? I mean, were they going to sleep? Or,
possibly.
You know? Well, it's very strange because it's perfectly obvious to me that this woman is a very focused, centred, positive, responsible teacher. She knows how to deal with situations. She's sympathetic, but she's tough, and she all those things. But she has this sense of humour and this but some critics really, you know. So that's when I get that. That's just an example.
Mm-mm-mm.
That's when I get pissed off with critics because they are, of course, in the end. One mustn't forget the fundamental truth is that the critic stands between your film and the audience, basically.
Yes, especially with world cinema, as you say, I think. Critics play a more important role than with Hollywood films, you know, where they can market their way to audiences to some extent.
I'm not sure whether that's true, I don't know.
You think?
I don't know whether that's true. I don't know that I agree with that.
I've seen some Hollywood films where which I thought were insufferable, and yet they...
Well, I see what you mean. They can buy their
way. They can still buy their way to audiences. Look, we've only got 20 more minutes, so let's have some interaction from you guys with Mike.
I also wrote my master's thesis on your film Naked. And when you look at your characters, they're really sophisticated and they have philosophical lines. They question life and they question their place in life. And some of my lecturers in the film school warned me about philosophy in film, and they said it doesn't really work in film, which I think it's ridiculous. But I wanted to ask, what's your opinion about philosophy's relation with cinema, and do you have any suggestions for us about writing?
Well, to answer your last question first, I don't know. I'm writing films is writing films. And writing is writing. I mean, you know, we are in a building which was designed by an architect somewhere along the line, and plans were made for that building. The plans no longer exist, or if they do, they're somewhere in an archive somewhere. We don't think about the plans, we think about the building. And writing films is only the equivalent of that. Writing a novel is different because that is the actual artifact itself. So the only advice, if I'm going to be pompous enough to give you advice, is that you remember when you're writing a film, you are merely creating the premise for exploration to happen that will be the film. That isn't to say that the writing shouldn't have as high a quality as possible in terms of a film script. But I do think it's important to remember that you are only writing the blueprint for a film. As to the question of philosophy, well, you know, I personally have never sat down, in fact, I've never thought of the question you're asking until this moment. I've never thought, do I want philosophy in my films? Should we have philosophy in films? Ought there to be? I've never thought about it at all. I mean, you know, the philosophical aspect of what you find in my films, such as it is a natural function of the characters and the themes of the film. So I don't... I would agree at one level with your tutors if they're saying beware of self-conscious, heavy-handed philosophy in a film. But if the philosophy... if that's what you choose to call it, is a function of, an actual function of, you know, is an expression of what the film is about, then great, you know. And it, of course, it's interesting what you say about the characters in my films. Some of them are sophisticated, some of them have views, but sometimes they are not sophisticated and they don't have any views. But you could still argue that in some way that is an expression of some kind of philosophy, either of them or of my view of them or of the world. So I've no idea whether that answers your question or not. Yeah.
Here's a question.
Yes, my question is, you were a filmmaker with a very distinct voice, and we are actually just beginning. So my question is, because you, I don't think you were born with that voice. How can you tell us something about how you, yeah, how you got where you are right now, like with your way of working, and how did you discover your voice as a filmmaker back in the days?
It's a hard. I would have been I would have been embarrassed to say to you, well, I was born with that voice. But since you said it, I think the point is, it is finding the voice you already have. I don't think you can find the voice you don't have, really. I mean, it comes out of the way you look at the world. And certainly, I know, if I'm honest, the way I look at the world is the way I was looking at the world in my cot, you know, as a baby, you know, in the war, so to speak, you know. And therefore, if I understand your question correctly, and this relates to what I've already talked about, I think it's you just have to find ways of being able to hold on to saying what you're saying and not be saying what you need to say or want to say, and not be and to constantly be aware that you have to avoid being inhibited or weighed down by or constrained by impositions from outside or technicalities, or you know, you have to learn to embrace the medium. We're talking about film here, and see it as an instrument to be played or a tool to be used, and not to be enslaved by it. I mean, one of the things that is afflicts many filmmakers is the notion that the film you make, the genre already exists, that you should make films like this or films like that or films that, you know, are in a particular genre or films that pay homage to, you know. Well, we all are sophisticated, and film is by its nature not a primitive medium, and therefore we're all influenced by as much as anybody, by all the films we've seen and the films that mean, the filmmakers that are important to us and things, and that somehow those things feed into our work. But the important thing is to hang on to your own voice and not to feel that you have to do the done thing or fit into an already existing category or genre or something. I suppose the bottom line is never compromise, I would say. Does that answer your question? And if it doesn't, tell me
maybe not entirely, because I wasn't as much talking about what you're having to say, but how you're saying it. And so you're working with film grammar, of course. And as a baby, you're not born with knowledge about actors or about, you know, how you can communicate through film. And there was one point that you chosen to choose this way of working, for example, or to center on the actors and on the do not work with a script, for example. And I know your background is in theater as well. So, and you were an actor as well. I read that as well. So, yeah, I was wondering how did that
I understand. It's sort of... I went off to train as an actor knowing that I did not want to be an actor, that I wanted to make things up, to tell stories. I wanted to be a writer. I went to acting school, and I went to art school as well, because I draw and paint, and I went to the London Film School. But I did all those things in the early 1960s because they were all part. I knew they were all part of a whole. And also, I suppose it would be important to say, since I get what you're asking me, that in the 60s, in the first half and the mid-60s, there was a great number of things suddenly started to happen that were the breaking down of formal post-war disciplines. Suddenly, in art and interrelated arts, art and poetry, there were things called happenings going on. You know, there were things, suddenly a lot of improvisational things were happening. And people were pouring oil paint over canvases and riding bicycles all over them, and out of which, more seriously, and Jackson Pollock, you know, but all sorts of things were happening in jazz and in film and in theatre and in literature. And that was the zeitgeist, and I was growing up a young person, and so that all influenced as well. Specifically, because I trained as an actor in the Royal Academy of Dramatic Art in London, which was very old-fashioned and very conservative, where we just did plays without any investigation or exploration. We just did the plays in a very superficial way, with no improvisation, or nothing that, I mean, you'd think Stanislavski hadn't existed half a century earlier, really. It was very, very dead. And I, given this, all this other stuff that was going on out there in the world, I spent the time there really thinking, this is very, you know, there's something very fundamentally uncreative about this. And then I went to art school where we were doing life drawing, you know, with a nude model. And one day I was in this studio where 20 of us were standing around drawing very quietly, and, you know, and I looked around the room and I thought, there's a thing happening in this room where everybody is really looking at life and finding a way of expressing it in a serious way. And what is happening in this room is something that never happened once in the acting school, because it was all just about learning the moves and not learning the lines and not really being connecting with something in here, looking at life. And that really made me start to think about the relationship between the creative process and the performer, the actor. And I began to realize that the process of writing and the process of rehearsing could become part of the same process, could be merged together. And of course, what's interesting about it objectively is that you can be absolutely sure that 1,000, 2,000, 3,000 years ago, before people were thinking about writing down scripts and then and doing all that, people were standing up and working and performing and creating material. You know, I'm quite sure in the medieval period, things were invented in the way that I thought I was inventing in the 1960s. I mean, Shakespeare's theatre undoubtedly involved a great deal of loose improvisational stuff, as is evidenced from the stuff that you find in the surviving folios. So I just started to realise that the whole process of writing and shooting and creating and character and all those things could be much more fluidly brought together. And that was helped by the fact that I was looking at, you know, learning about acting from one angle, directing from another angle, design from another angle, and seeing that they're all part of the one whole. So that maybe in some way answers your question.
What do you have prior to casting? What do you have in terms, how much do you know about characters, about the plot, about maybe how the film will end, about, you know, generally the story?
Normally, and I say that by which I mean, as opposed to this particular film that you saw yesterday, which is obviously drawn from history, but normally, nothing at all. Or at least, to be more accurate, ideas, feelings, notions, possibilities, preoccupations, things I think, well, maybe it's about time I dealt with this, sort of.
it varies really from film to film. But the important thing is that I approach the thing of casting with a very, very open mind. The job is for me normally is to decide on actors, is to work with actors, which I always do, even including in this film, who are primarily character actors, people who are versatile, people who don't just play themselves, but who are good at playing real people out there in the street. And so I can sit down with an actor and start to do development, and we don't know what the character is going to be, and we gradually try things and do things. And for me, I'm doing a creative process. I'm discovering as part of the whole thing, and things are starting to come out. Sometimes I've got a more concrete notion in certain areas, and sometimes ideas creep up on me, and I suddenly realise that what I'm actually doing is something that I have subconsciously been thinking about, you know. But it is about being as open with the brief as possible. As to knowing how a film will end and so forth, I invariably don't know how it... I can have shot three quarters of the film and still not know how it's going to end sometimes, quite often actually. I mean, Naked is a case in point. We'd shot most of the film, and whether he should stay or go with his girlfriend, you know, we just couldn't... The possibilities were all very strong, and I couldn't get the handle on exactly what should happen. And then I would drive to the location, this house, this Gothic house that you remember as the focus of the action in a lot of the film. And I would drive, and I'd drive down this long road, and the house is at the end, and I'd see it. And I didn't really pay attention to it. And then one day I suddenly noticed, I'd been looking at it for some considerable time, for some weeks, and suddenly it came to me. I just saw him staggering down this road in my head, you know. And that, immediately I thought of that, then I realised what the philosophical end of the film should be, that he should steal the money and go, and it would end like that. And but that, so that really is a case of the visual, of the cinematic idea feeding back into the philosophical meaning of what needed to happen.
Anybody else? I just want to ask you actually about... Oh, do we get a hand?
Yes, you said something about the individual approach to working with actors on the rehearsals. Can you tell us something more about that?
Yes. What I always do is to get each actor... by the way, when I talk about working with them individually, I mean individually in a very private situation. So it's the sessions are just one-on-one. Nobody else there, no assistant directors or nobody else. Just me and the actor. That's important. What I always do is to get the actor to think of a lot of people of the same sex as him or her that they've actually known in real life. Sometimes quite a long lists, you know, sometimes more than 100, or sometimes 50, depending. And I then will talk about all these people. That's to say, there must be real people that the actor has known in life at some stage or other. And eventually I will whittle it down to one or two or three, and we'll then start to get the actor, ask the actor to start to do the people, and we put them together. And so those are the source of the character, and it means that we've got a starting point as distinct from saying, well, just be somebody. It's got to come from something, so the actor has got some tangible source to work from. What then happens is that we'll work and move it and develop it and change it and grow it, so the character will grow from that. And of course, apart from anything else, the characters start to be affected by how they affect each other, by in the way that happens in real life. But that's the primary thing that I do. And even on Mr. Turner, all of those characters, I've got people to think about somebody or other to use as the basis. It's just so that the actor has somewhere to start and something to be, something concrete to use, somebody.
Hi, we're talking about visual storytelling, so I'm interested to know, where does the DOP comes into the process of development of your films? And
where does the what, sorry?
The cinematographer, the director of photography. And generally, how much of a creative freedom does a DOP have in your films? Like, where's the fair balance between your vision and the vision of the DOP?
Well, as I've already said, I mean, if it's not both of our vision, then it doesn't work. It has to be a shared thing. And as I was saying earlier, the important thing, the good news is when one works with somebody that is on the same wavelength. I mean, I've worked with the same DOP for a very long time, Dick Pope, who has shot everything since 1990. First of all, in the development, in the rehearsal, the preparatory period, there will always come a point. I mean, to start with, I go off and just work with the actors and we get stuff on the go. Then there will come a moment when it's important that I sit down with Dick Pope, with the cinematographer, and the designer, and the costume designer, and the makeup designer, but primarily with the cinematographer, and share the principal ideas or feelings that I have at that stage, so that we will have some kind of dialogue on the go as to the spirit of the film, the feeling of the film, and therefore coming out of that, the possible look of the film, the palette of the film. And then we'll always shoot tests of one kind or another, to start to, So we've got a discussion on the go about the visual philosophy of the film before we ever get to the shoot. Then, it's important that the cinematographer, the DOP, has input in the choice of locations and so forth. Though primarily, that's a choice for the designer and me. Nevertheless, the DOP's input is very important, both from a conceptual and creative point of view, but also, of course, from a practical point of view. When it comes to the actual shoot, I will rehearse a scene by... We create each scene by scene, by sequence, location by location, by, as I said earlier, rehearsing, improvising, and then stopping and, through rehearsal, write it in a very precise way in the location. Now, I do that without the DOP there. So in other words, I arrive at what is the material. Sometimes I'll construct it knowing that it means that we need to shoot it like this, and it's constructed accordingly. Sometimes I'll construct a scene, particularly longer, more complex scenes, where I won't really make any decisions at all as to how we're going to shoot it, and I'll leave that open. What happens as soon as we get to the next stage is that we assemble everybody, we run the scene so that the DOP and indeed everybody else can see it, and then he and I will simply talk, discuss, and work out how we're going to shoot. We don't storyboard, we don't, occasionally there are certain kinds of action, as in any film, that you have to pre-plan. I mean, there are certain kinds of big things where, lighting has to go in the day before or 2 days ahead or whatever it is, and therefore you've got to make some decisions about where the camera is going to be. But apart from those technical set pieces, when it comes to the actual organic action, he and I will look at it, discuss it. The actors will stay there, they will run it, they'll stop, they'll be very patient while we work out how we're going to shoot. Sometimes it's very straightforward. Sometimes I may say to him, I think it's this. And he may say, well, actually,
I was watching it from over there, and actually if we shot it from over there, then the light, something, you know, would, so I look at it and we negotiate it and I go with it, or, you know, it's a shared thing. The great thing about, and this goes back to what I was saying about Vermeer, the great thing about a cinematographer, a DOP like Dick Pope, is that he is happy to be in love with a very static shot with things just happening within the frame, as he is with handheld or complicated tracking shots. Each thing is interesting in its own right, depending on the needs of the scene and the rhythm and the dynamics of what's going on in the shape of the film at that stage. So it's about sharing, it's certainly not about one or other of us dogmatically imposing ideas on the other, and it's certainly not about conflict. It's about sharing and agreeing and working to a common cause, obviously.
Thank you.
Any more questions?
On the whole, it's practical. I've worked with two producers over the last 25 years or something, one of whom died, and the other one was our assistant, who now is a producer. And both of them were brilliant at the practical overseeing and organisation of the film. Neither of them had any wish to interfere creatively. But that's the basic thing. But a good producer has to understand the film, has to understand the spirit of the film, and the nature of what we're doing. And therefore, my producer now, Georgina Lowe, is... She doesn't really have creative input and doesn't want to, but she couldn't organise it as well as she does if she wasn't absolutely sympathetic to what it actually is. So when you have a producer who is unsympathetic or is only concerned with money or practicalities without being sympathetic, then they can't make the right decisions because they can't negotiate between what's needed and what's expedient or what's practical. So I think that would be the answer, really. We're nearly there,
I think. Just one last question then here.
You told us that you had a problem with the budget. Can you tell me which changes did you make with that?
Yeah, well, I already have. I mean, as I said, we expected, talking about Mr. Turner, presumably, are you?
Yes, of course.
We expected automatically that we would see Turner in Venice. But there came a stage when we said, I just kept saying, there's no way we can make this film if you don't see him in Venice. And eventually, the crunch came, and I had to decide either we make the film and you don't see him in Venice, or we don't make the film. We don't make the film at all. Well, that was a choice not to be made, you know. Basically, that's the crudest illustration. There are various things. I mean, we would have gone onto the. We would have come onto the to France and Germany and Switzerland, you know, for example. And in fact, at the beginning of the film, when you see him in Holland with a windmill, in fact, that is in England, in Suffolk, which is the other part of Holland on the English side, you know, where there are windmills and it's flat. You know.
So you were shooting that in the end of the shooting?
Pardon?
You were shooting that scene in the end of the shooting days?
Yes.
Okay. Thank you.
Mike, thank you so much for sharing so much of your insights with such candor today.
Thank you very much.